Welcome, everyone. Thank you for taking time out of your very busy day to attend our class's final presentation on the collaborative work that we did with the MinKwon Center for Community Action on our study of the Flushing waterfront. Go to the next slide. This is a photograph actually that was taken during the beginning of the semester when we did a tour of the downtown Flushing waterfront with members of our class and the MinKwon Center. In fact, we can see that S.J. Jung, the president of the MinKwon Center, is photographed here, and he accompanied us. So this was taken in the very beginning of the semester. It lists down who all of our students are. I should also introduce myself and say that my name is Tari Hum, and I'm a faculty member in the Department of Urban Studies. And Julianne Langhammer was the teaching assistant for our class. And then everyone else listed, I think we're going to go around and introduce, just say our names. And this was the class that did all the hard work. So this is really their labor of love that we're going to be reviewing in a minute. So, Alex, why don't you introduce yourself quickly? Classes that are offered, I think at many undergraduate programs. I'm an urban planner, and so I actually, I teach an introduction to urban planning class, but I like to also teach classes that are more like urban planning workshops that addresses a ongoing planning issue in various communities. So we partnered with the MinKwon Center for Community Action on a study of the Flushing waterfront, and maybe now is a good time for Steve Cho, who is the executive director of the MinKwon Center, to say a few words about our partnership.
Hi, I'm Steve Choi. You guys all know me. The executive director of the MinKwon Center for Community Action. But, you know, I think when Professor Hum came along with this idea of a class, it really fit in very well with what we were thinking. Over the years, we've become more and more involved in a lot of local issues, whether it's the Flushing Municipal Parking Lot development or a lot of other issues that really hit home for a lot of local Flushing residents. So it really was a very fortuitous occurrence that she came by because we thought this is exactly what we want to get involved in, something that's grassroots, something that's going to go into the community to utilize some various sorts of grassroots organizing methods like surveying, like going door-to-door, and really getting community input on what the needs are for our community and really helping that shape exactly what development is going to look like. For too long, development in Flushing has really been about what Mayor Bloomberg wants or about what, you know, rich developers want. And so little of it has been about what the community wants. So we just thought it was an absolutely fabulous opportunity to work together. And so, you know, I think a lot of our staff is here because I think we have a lot invested in this project as well. You know, we really helped to work together and very collaboratively with the class to make sure that these surveys happen. And we really see this as the first step. I think that there's a lot more steps that are going to be involved as the development continues. And, you know, at the end of the day, we think this potentially could be, the development could be a positive sign for the Flushing community. But I think we're going to have to continue to make sure that the community's voices are represented so that it really brings benefits to the community. And I think we'll see later on as to what exactly the community is looking for.
Great, thank you. I should also say that this class was supported by the Queens College Asian American Center. Dr. Modalika Khandelwal couldn't be here today to offer her congratulations to all of you guys for doing some great work, but she is very supportive of promoting college, university, and community partnerships to do similar kinds of research. I should also make note that the Asian American Research Institute is here and is also filming this and will be archiving it on their website to make it available. And Carol Huang is here, who is the Director of Research from ARI, so we thank you for being here. Okay, great. We're going to get started with some of our findings, and this is a slide that basically tells us who we are and the kinds of research work that we did over the semester. We conducted various kinds of surveys in collaboration with the MinKwon Center. We met with various stakeholders. We toured the Flushing waterfront. And so this was a class that depended on a lot of field work and a lot of collaboration with the community expertise of the MinKwon Center. So the next slide. I think this is just an aerial shot of our study area, and we can see Northern Boulevard in the north, and then Roosevelt Avenue to the south, and we can see College Point Boulevard, and those blocks and lots that are within the circle are actually part of our detailed land use survey that we're not going to go into great detail here, but will be part of the report that we'll be preparing to provide to the MinKwon Center. But this gives you an idea of where the Flushing River is, where it's situated, and downtown Flushing. And with that, I think that I'm going to then ask our next student presenter to come up and present the next slides. Okay, Audra.
Okay, hello. So I'm going to introduce you to the geographical history of the Flushing River. The Flushing River, or Flushing Creek as it is historically known, has had a long and varied history. It was once used for imports and trading and recreational use, but now it's used for freight and industry. It is a survivor. Scientists say that the Flushing River is at least 3 million years old. So just to imagine that something in our backyard is that old is kind of really amazing. The river flows through the northern part of central Queens into the East River, which obviously also flows by Manhattan. It's located in a valley that may have been a large riverbed before the last ice age that once divided Queens into an eastern and western half. So if you can imagine, Queens used to be divided actually by what is now the Flushing River, and it was two parts, which it's not like that anymore, but it used to be like that. And this map shows the Flushing River as it used to be in 1891. I believe at that point, the Flushing River was still used for recreational purposes. So if you could go to the next slide. The source of the Flushing River was once located in what is now known as Kew Gardens Hills. Many years ago, the location was called Head of the Valley. Valley is a Dutch word for valley, so it was where the Queens Valley started. And the source of the river was the start of the valley, obviously. The area near the mouth of the creek became the site of the 1645 Dutch settlement named Vlissingen. Vlissingen was the original name for Flushing. It was named after a port. It also said that Vlissingen means salt meadow, and that means that they were giving a nod to the meadows of Flushing. And if you take a look, you'll notice that in this picture, you can actually see, but not quite see, the source of the Flushing River. It's where all the turnpikes converge, where the Grand Central Expressway, the Van Wyck, Union Turnpike, and the Jackie Robinson all converge. So if you're driving and you feel like you want a little Flushing history, you want to look out your back window and see some history, the Flushing River is there, but you most likely won't be able to see it. But it's there. Thank you.
The Flushing River has always been a source of political debate.
Tell us.
My name is Alex Stolivares. The areas including and surrounding Flushing have been drastically changed by the 1939 World's Fair and the dredging of the Flushing River by Robert Moses. Travel from the western half of Queens to the eastern half of Queens was made easier through highways that eventually blocked the source of the river, so the river was drained into Flushing Meadows Park. Before 1930, you could cross the Flushing River in two ways, a drawbridge or a boat, and there were two drawbridges. There's one on Roosevelt Avenue and one on the Northern Boulevard Bridge. Next slide. These bridges eventually became fixed bridges, and the Northern Boulevard Bridge was raised so that concrete barges can flow through. However, the Roosevelt Avenue Bridge, when it was fixed, it wasn't raised, so it limited the use of the river and is now up to where we know it is today.
Hi, my name is Jean Kasanoff, industry along the Flushing River. So Flushing was established in the 1600s as a mainly residential neighborhood, and it remained so for most of its early history, and the creek was designated as belonging to Flushing. Before the first bridge was built over it in 1800, people crossed it by way of ferry and rowboat to get to other parts of Queens. And for a considerable amount of time, it was also considered a recreational area, as you can see from the picture, which shows a boathouse just south of Northern Boulevard around 1890. But by this time, Flushing had also become home to a number of manufacturing establishments, most of which were in the building supply industry. This trend continued to build in Flushing well into the 20th century, as the boroughs were increasingly connected by highways and rail and railways. And as construction efforts required by the World's Fair drew more manufacturing and construction companies to the area. Thus, the waterfront came to be known as an area dominated by manufacturing and industrial establishments, and it's still home to a number of such establishments. And most of the traffic on the river is concrete barges. It is clearly no longer considered a recreational area. But in 1998, the area around the river was rezoned from the M3 category for manufacturing to the C42 and C43 categories for more mixed and commercial uses. So this creates an opportunity to bring more housing and businesses to the waterfront and create a waterfront that is more accessible and public friendly. Okay, so current conditions of the waterfront. It's clear that the area is at a crossroads, which is exemplified by the fact that the new Musk development, or Skyview Tower, is directly across the street from the Knightship Land Houses. And throughout the area, there are varying levels of industry and construction. And as we conducted our land use survey of the waterfront along College Point Boulevard between Roosevelt and Northern, we made a number of observations about the area. First of all, it's very hard to actually get up close to the waterfront. In most places, it's blocked from view and from access by buildings and by fence blocks. And the closest you can actually get to it is in the back of the Yaffe Plaza parking lot. And once you're there, you'll notice that the river often has garbage floating in it and it's giving off a foul odor. Along College Point Boulevard between Roosevelt and Northern, there's very little pedestrian traffic, and most often there's none at all. There's a lot of foot traffic in and out of the Skyview Center, but almost none of that ever crosses north over Roosevelt into the rest of College Point Boulevard. There is little to no boat or barge traffic on the river, and the area is populated mostly by building supply manufacturers, and also a number of vacant lots. Some areas have severely weathered and neglected sidewalks, especially the section of Roosevelt between College Point and the waterfront. And here we just have a few pictures of that area. In the upper left-hand corner is a picture of a large vacant lot on the corner of Janet and Roosevelt. Next to it is a gate towards the Roosevelt Avenue Bridge on that same lot, which suggests that people used to stop there and look at something, which is no longer there to look at. In the lower left-hand corner is the corner of Roosevelt and Janet, and even though there's barely any pedestrian traffic, the sidewalks are very neglected and weathered. And another picture across the street from that picture shows the same thing. You can see that the sidewalks are neglected and that's a few people. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Suji Lin. So this is the actual waterfront at 3908 Janet Place. Right now, it's used as a dumping ground. Right here, you can see the tractor that's like all rusty, and there's the historic U-Haul tower. So it's owned by LED Developers at this point. It's a global real estate company that plans to develop luxury condominiums, retail and commercial. At the right is a lumberyard for construction across Skyview Park. Can't really see in the picture that well, but like that's like exactly the point where you can't really see what's going on there.
How you doing, everyone? I'm Sean Dalquez. I'm talking about key stakeholders. Obviously with development this side, there was a lot of people who had a voice, but there was several main voices that had concerns dealing with the downtown Flushing framework. With the New York City EDC, the Economic Development Corporation, corporation is considered the city's primary engine for economic development. All right, and their, one of their main initiatives is to revitalize and reconnect Flushing to its waterfront and redevelop the neighboring Willets Point. All right, the next one is the DCP, the Department of City Planning. Basically, the DCP designates the zoning of land. In regards to downtown Flushing, they plan on supporting the process of BOA and advocate for mixed use and residential development, as well as supporting and maintaining industrial use of the Flushing River on Northern Boulevard. In addition, the DCP plans on increasing public access to the waterfront. Next one is Flushing Willets Point LDC. Flushing Willets Point Corona LDC, the local development corporation, was created by Mayor Bloomberg with three main goals in mind. And his three main goals were clean up the 60-acre side of the waterfront, connect the river to the other areas of Flushing, and transform the waterfront into a viable community resource of recreational activity. Next one was the Community Board for Flushing, Community Board 7. CB7, basically we met with Marilyn Bitterman and Chuck Apelian. The main issues that were brought up in that meeting, and I actually remember after there, was kind of provide a balanced development. So there's something for everybody in Flushing. That was their main goal or their main objective as far as with Flushing. The Asian Americans for Equality Incorporated, AFI, is a deeply rooted nonprofit community development organization, which actually established in 1974. Their first offices were in Chinatown, and then they branched out to Flushing. Their main concern is, a lot of the stakeholders' main concern is basically, a lot of the community's main concern is real affordable housing with this development, and for the residents of the community. And finally, the MinKwon Center for Community Action is who we partnered up with this semester with our urban studies class. And the MinKwon Center was formerly known as the Young Korean American Service and Education Center until it changed its name to MinKwon in 2009. And what I thought was interesting, MinKwon is a Korean word and it means civil rights. And I think by action, the group shows that. And especially by the way, like this class was unique and we were able to go from just being like a lecture college class to actually do service work and able to go out in the community and actually see how things operate, see what you learn actually works in the field. And, you know, they showed us that in that class along with Professor Terry Holm. And, you know, they're living up to their name and they've been helping the Korean immigrant community since 1989. So, thank you very much, MinKwon Center, and thank you.
Okay, so I'll go over the Downtown Flushing Framework. It was brought up in 2004 by the EDC and the DCP. So basically, Municipal Lot 1 will become Flushing Commons. It'll have like 17-story buildings with a water fountain, greenery, and parking for 1,600 cars will be provided. Right now, it houses about 1,100 spots, but we think that it won't be enough. The next one is Willets Point. The plan for Willets Point is a 61-acre new neighborhood. It's the light green one in the picture. Mm-hmm. So right now, it's called the Iron Triangle, and it houses a lot of auto body shops that New York City is actually trying to use eminent domain to seize. And it'll have all these things, a convention center, a hotel, entertainment venues, open space, and even a public school. And this is the Flushing Waterfront, the one that's owned by LED Development. Here it looks pretty generic in that just these chunky buildings just kind of looks like Queen's Crossing. So I don't think much is going to be different. They are going to have the same things like luxury condominiums, the retail, the commercial, and a pedestrian bridge will link the waterfront to downtown Flushing, Willets Point, and Corona. So far, recreational use in the waterfront, in the actual water, hasn't been brought up yet.
Hello everyone, my name is Manika Talisker. I'll be talking a little about Plaza, Flushing, Willets Point, Corona, LDC. So we held a series of meetings with our with some of our key stakeholders, and one of them was Flushing, Willets Point, Corona, LDC. So we'll give you an overview of the organization. It's an organization comprised of both public and private stakeholders that aims for the planned development of areas including Flushing, Willets Point, and Corona. However, the organization has been around 4 years, but since 2009, the LTC has shifted their focus to downtown Flushing and the Flushing Riverfront. And it's the recipient of a New York State Brownfield Opportunity Areas grant, and the grant will be used to develop a BOA nomination slash master plan and draft generic environmental impact study. So drawing from our talks with Nick Roberts, who is the program manager of the LPC, and the RFP, we gained an understanding of some of the key goals that the LDC had for the waterfront and for downtown Flushing. So one of the key goals is kind of linking together, creating a link to downtown Flushing, Willets Point, and Corona through the waterfront and environmental remediation and cleanup of the waterfront, and providing access to the waterfront alongside the waterfront, being on the waterfront, and preserving the industrial uses of the waterfront. One of the understandings that we got is that public access to the waterfront would actually bring about development west of Main Street, consequently relieving some of the congestion on Main Street, as well as reconnecting downtown Flushing to the water. That picture on the lower right is actually of how maybe access to the waterfront would look like. You can see there's people biking down and walking along, and I think there's a boat on the water, so they kind of really want you to use of the waterfront at its best. Can you go to the next one? So some of the goals that the LDC has for the consultant can we go back to the previous slide? Yeah. The LDC also hopes to see long-term development that is conducive to affordable housing units, affordable and senior housing units, and it's actually advocated specific sites for these units, one of them being Municipal Lot Number 1. It's also invested in improving transportation, where they did think about having an exit slash entrance on Prince Street. However, due to infrastructure issues, that would probably not happen. And so they're focusing more on the renovation of the Long Island Railroad Station. So some of the key goals that the LDC is looking for their consultant to address is comprehensive study of the BOA and the following existing info on land ownership, indexing of buildings and historically significant sites, current transportation, traffic, parking, infrastructure, and actual sites on the waterfront that could be where we could see this development. Also, one of the key goals that's really important to our class and the MinKwon Center is outreach to community. So the consultant would be required to actually work with community organizations to produce development plans and recommendations that are in tune with the needs of the community. Community issues the consultant would be required to engage and involve the community by holding town halls and holding talks with community organizations, and this would be a great deal of potential for community organizations like the MinKwon Center to advocate and push for the development that their communities would like to see. So this is just a rendering of what the Flushing Riverfront would look like as it meets purple at this point.
Hi, everybody. My name is Natalie Rojas, and I'm focusing on Vision 2020. And Vision 2020 is a comprehensive waterfront plan that the city is offering. New York City, out of the boroughs of New York City, 4 out of the 5 boroughs are in islands, and the 5th one is a peninsula. There is 520 miles that can be developed for the waterfront. For Vision 2020, the city put 8 different points that they will be focusing on every site. Those sites are 22, which are called reaches, and Flushing is part of Reach 11. There's 4 types of waterfronts, and the 4 types are natural waterfronts, public waterfronts, working waterfronts, and redeveloped waterfronts. So these are the 8 different goals. It's very important for the city to have access to the water. So as you guys can see, there's some kayaking. They're not very sure if that will be the case in Flushing, but they would like to have activities like boats and ferries and actually access to in water, like beaches. It's also important for the city to work with the working environment in the waterfront, like the cruises. And to improve the quality of the water. They will also be expanding bike paths along the waterfront. For Vision 2020, Reach 11, I have to breathe. This is actually the area for Flushing, as you guys can see, is right there in the peninsula. There will be studies of the water to see if it's possible to go into it, but for sure there will be access by biking from Willets Point to Flushing. There will also be possible recreational boats, and I think that's it.
Hello, I'm Jake from MinKwon Center. I'm a housing organizer, and through this survey, I felt a lot of things. It's because it was really a good opportunity to work with students. It's a good opportunity for students, have a better understanding of what the community's opinion about the Flushing, redevelopment. I mean, one good thing, that I thought through the survey is people is really, passionate to participate in the survey. When we ask them to participate in the survey, they kind of kindly, participated. And on the other end, they don't have any interest on the survey. They just, basically refuse it. Right. Even if I, ask them multiple times, they just refuse to, hey, I'm having a dinner with my family, don't ruin my dinner. So I just, ask them, oh, so at some point, it's gonna be more important than your one-time dinner. But they just refuse me to do it. Anyway, a lot of times I ask them, to participate in the survey, and they kindly participated, and then I realized that the sad thing, because the awareness of this Flushing redevelopment is very low among all communities. That's another thing. So I think it was really a good opportunity to educate and to let community know about these issues, because these issues really affecting our community, such as our marginalized community, especially for low income or middle income, right? So yeah, it was really good, to work with you guys, basically.
So Regina and I will talk a little about some of the findings with the resident surveys. In conjunction with the MinKwon Center, we conducted 151 resident surveys, and some of our key findings are here. So of our survey respondents, Asians were the racial majority, and if we break that down further by ethnicity, the Chinese population was half of the Asian population, and it was followed by 25% of Koreans. More than half of the survey sample can speak English fluently, and most of the surveys were conducted in English. And a significant percentage of the surveyed residents were 22 to 49 years of age, the household incomes, the highest percentages were for 10 to 20,000, which was 19%, and 21% had $50,000 to $60,000 yearly income, which really goes to show how much of the respondents had mixed income. Yeah. respondents moved to Flushing. More than 25% listed friends and family in the area. Many also listed that Flushing was close to their workplace. However, less than 5% of the respondents indicated that their move was based on Flushing being less expensive than their old neighborhood. So some of the changes that residents observed in the past 5 years, they've definitely experienced like the high cost of living. When you see 32% found that housing is no longer affordable, while 31% have observed that everyday goods are becoming more and more expensive. But the most significant change that residents have seen is, if you look at that percentage right there, 34% found that there is they've been seeing construction of luxury buildings such as Skyview Park.
And when we asked the residents what their top neighborhood quality concerns were, a majority said that parking was the largest concern for them, followed by sanitation and street beautification. And as downtown Flushing continues to become developed, they will eventually become more crowded and parking space will become limited. And when we did speak with a lot of our stakeholders, they did bring up the issue of sanitation and street beautification as important issues for the future of downtown Flushing, and they noted that the piling of garbage in front of housing or in front of restaurants that are left without being picked up, and they attract a lot of unwanted vermin, and they really want some type of action towards cleaning that up. And I know that Community Board 7 also mentioned some type of uniform signage around downtown Flushing area. And as you can see, a majority of our survey respondents were not aware of the downtown Flushing framework, as Jake had mentioned earlier. But when we did explain to them what the plans would entail, a lot of them supported it. And even though the plans of the downtown Flushing framework may not address the actual needs of the community, we think that most of the residents felt that any type of development on the waterfront would benefit its current condition, which makes it really important for community organizations like MinKwon to educate residents about the type of community development that will occur in the future of downtown Flushing, because we want to make sure that they are actually meeting the residents' needs and serving the community. And one of the final questions in our survey was asking residents what would they like to see on the Flushing waterfront. And the top four visions for the Flushing waterfront was park and open space, which is 71%, affordable housing, jobs, and a pedestrian path. So we can see that there's an obvious desire to develop the waterfront, and a lot of residents see that they want to see more open space in their community, and providing jobs and affordable housing are more pressing concerns than condominiums or ferry to Manhattan or more retail. And so we could see that a lot of the concerns for the Flushing waterfront is creating access to the waterfront and really meeting community needs.
So we also surveyed small businesses during the course of our semester, and we actually surveyed 98 small businesses, and you'll find that some of the answers they gave were very similar to the answers that residents gave. So there is some sort of harmony in what Flushing residents want, whether they be business owners, workers, or whether they just live there and commute somewhere else to work. Okay, so out of 98 small businesses surveyed, we found that respondents were 97% Asian, so that's a very large majority. Of that 97% majority, 66% were Chinese, and the rest were other types of Asian. In the past 5 years, a full 55% of those we surveyed responded that they've seen a worse business climate. So whether that means less customers, customers or whether that means more taxes being imposed on them. We didn't get into that much detail, but they did say that they see a worse business climate. So it's up to speculation to see what that means. Only 3% own their shops. 97% of all people who either own a business or work there work for someone who rents. So that's a very interesting statistic. The average number of employees are 4.7. Also, another interesting point to notice is that only 7% of businesses receive government assistance, whether that's because they don't know that the resources are there for them, or it's a language barrier, or they're afraid to seek out those resources, we don't know. Also, 7% of businesses belong to chambers of commerce, business associations. So that would also be an important point of the community, getting, you know, people to join these associations, because there's always solidarity in numbers. Next slide, please. A full 87% of business owners are from Flushing. So that's very interesting, because they not only serve their community, but they live in the community. So they're a vital part of the community. We also noted that the majority of people we surveyed responded that they spoke English, whether it be some English or fluently. Some English was 66%, and a full 28% of respondents declared that they were fluent in English. Okay, next slide now. So we wanted to answer the question, who shops in downtown Flushing? So we found out that a full 55% of people who shop in Flushing are people who actually live in Flushing. So this means that these shops serve a vital role for the community, because not only are they located there, but the community that they serve is where their shops are. It's not like they're going and, you know, like in Manhattan, tourists come and they buy things. This is actually for the community. It's by the community, for the community. So it's very vital. Next slide. We asked the small business owners what type of improvements they would like to see for the environment, so for downtown Flushing as a whole. An overwhelming majority, 74%, said they would like parking. So we wonder how that would tie in with the development of the municipal lot one, because we do know that there's going to be 1,600 parking spaces, but obviously there would be more street traffic, there would be less area to park on the street. A full 56% wanted sanitation or better sanitation, and we know that that is a problem in downtown Flushing. 46% said they wanted street beautification. If you also take a look at these, you notice that these answers definitely echo the answers of the residents. So it's very interesting. It seems like all these answers and the pressing needs represent the Flushing community at large, not just, you know, sectors of the community. So next slide, please. This slide shows the awareness of the downtown Flushing framework. And like my colleagues, I guess, that spoke about the residents, the small business respondents were also unaware of the downtown Flushing framework. So more than half of them, unfortunately, were unaware. So we can only speculate as to why: a language barrier, people don't feel connected to the community, they might feel like it's a transient community, they might, you know, be afraid to seek out other people in the neighborhood and really sort of form a community. We don't know why they're not aware. They might be isolated from the American community at large. We don't know why. Okay, so next slide. We asked the Flushing small business workers and owners what they would like to see for the waterfront. And an overwhelming majority wanted a park or open space. So this really speaks to the point that there's a lack of green space in Flushing. I mean, if you try to look for a park, there's few and far between. There's Flushing Meadows Corona, which is kind of a little bit out of the way. There's also the park by the Bland houses, but it's not really an open space. I mean, where can you go and just hang out by a fountain or read a book on a bench? It's kind of hard to do. So 65% wanted a park or open space by the waterfront. 37% wanted both affordable housing and childcare. And as I mentioned before, this also echoes what the residents were saying that they wanted for Flushing. And coming in last, actually, was the ferry to Manhattan, which is very interesting because you would think that for a job, people would commute to Manhattan, but it seems like the people who live here mostly work in Flushing. So maybe that's why they wouldn't want a ferry to Manhattan. So next slide. I think that's the last one. Yeah, you can stay on there, I guess. So Basically, some of the key points small business survey responses brought up were the lack of adequate sanitation, the need for open spaces, and the need for street beautification. All of Flushing stakeholders, therefore, seem to have the same ideas on quality of life issues, no matter who they are. Thank you.
I'm Julianne Lane Cameron. I just wanted to include the hard work and labor of our class, paired with MinKwon Center. You can find out more about MinKwon at minkwon.org. And Queens College, thank you to Professor Hum at the Urban Studies Department. You'll be able to find up our PowerPoint shortly, and we are in the works of making a paper based on more details of our research. Also, for more information in our slides, the EDC website's up, the DCP, and the Flushing Corona, the Flushing Willets Point Corona LDC. So, thank you.
Students' presentations, and I guess that we can take some questions, or maybe Steve, if we want to facilitate a discussion of some of the findings.
Sure. Can someone explain the design of survey process, and then what do you think could be improved?
That's a good question. Mm-hmm. Someone, do you want to talk about that?
We definitely went back and forth a couple times. Mm-hmm. So Professor Hum would you know, did you guys create the survey?
We used templates from other community surveying efforts. So the resident survey, we used a template from the Asian American Legal Defense and Education Fund, who have been doing extensive surveying of Asian American communities that have high poverty rates. And they are just now completing that study. So we had that template for the resident survey, which we modified. So actually, part of the survey includes questions about housing conditions that will be made available to the MinKwon Center, the responses. But we didn't include it in the PowerPoint presentation because it wasn't directly related to the Flushing waterfront. So we used templates that have been used by other community organizations, and we modified them to meet the needs, the research needs of our collaborative project. And we should also note that the surveys were translated into Chinese and to Korean so there was a try, and then Spanish, that's right, in Spanish. So we were able to have surveys in different languages, and it was great to be paired up also with organizers that spoke multiple languages.
So we went back and forth a number of times to try to really refine the survey instrument. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, after really doing it, I think we definitely could have improved. And I think it's something to kind of for us to file away for the next time we do a survey. But at the end of the day, I do think that it was an effective survey, and I think it was good. And, you know, I think it's great that we were able to get so many filled out. I mean, I did it a bunch of times, and a lot of times it was kind of long, so people halfway through would be like, I can't do this anymore. Just give it back to me. But I think that we were able to get a lot of really detailed information. I think that was a really great accomplishment.
That's right. There are responses to some open-ended questions also that's not reflected up here. But and the students and the MinKwon organizers worked through spring break. So they were very dedicated.
Can you tell me more about about your class, like how you guys, what the class is, what level of school it is, and why you decided to do this project, and why Flushing? And also, kind of what the like I don't know if the government is going to be looking at these at all, or not the government, but I mean, you know, like the LDC or the EDC, if any of them are taking, if they're going to be looking at anything you guys did or looking at. And also, the other thing I was going to ask is where you got the renderings from.
Where did we got the what?
The renderings from? I haven't seen this.
The renderings. Oh, so, okay. Our students can talk. Yeah, I think that they actually went on to the websites of the Flushing, Willets Point, Corona, LLC, and to the Downtown Flushing Framework websites. They're all up there, and that's, I think, where they got most of their renderings from. This is an urban studies class, and I think that most of our students, actually, I've taught this class before, and it was in composition more mixed in terms of graduate and undergraduate students. I think for the most part, our class was largely undergrads, except for one graduate student, Natalie, who is also going to go on in the fall to do a architecture program at University of Oregon. So we're going to lose her here at Queens College. But why Flushing? Because Flushing is, because that's where Queens College is located. So we are also a stakeholder in this community. And also our college, our motto, I think, is that we learn to serve and
we learn so that we may serve.
And our provost actually has a very strong emphasis on service learning and wants to promote service learning courses. So I'm actually hoping that this kind of urban studies class, that we don't stay in the classroom and that we actually partner with a community organization, because the students have learned so much by going out into downtown Flushing and talking with residents and small business owners and workers. And that was only possible because of the credibility of the MinKwon Center and our collaboration. Otherwise, it would have been very difficult for me as a an instructor at Queens College to be able to make those kinds of trusting relationships that people would respond to surveys. So I think that it's mutually beneficial, I hope it was mutually beneficial. But certainly I see the great value in having our students do field work and also producing knowledge and producing research that may be useful to the community.
I mean, I just want to say that I think that when you are thinking about getting the community involved and you're thinking about doing a particular campaign from an advocate's perspective, that first part is so important. Getting the information from the community, getting the feedback from the community. Is this something that they want? Is this something they don't want? You know, a lot of times we're able to find out a lot of information we don't know. We wouldn't have known if when we actually do start asking and do start going door to door and talking to people on an individual basis. So I think that's a step that's often forgotten when folks are thinking about, you know, the various different kinds of developments or whatever. And I think that that's really what the advocate's role is, and that's what the community group's role is, to be there to remind folks and say, look, at the end of the day, you know, this project has to also capture the voice of the community. And, you know, I think moving forward, you know, I think there's a real opportunity to bring together a lot of different parts of the Flushing community. Because I think this is going to affect us all, whether, you know, whatever language or ethnicity or whatever you're coming from. I think that things like affordable housing, open space, you know, jobs, whatever it is, I think these are things that affect our community as a whole. So, you know, I think that we're going to continue to make sure that we are at the table and trying to get a lot of different voices at the table as well.
It seems like very interesting to find that 57% of the people who were surveyed didn't know a lot of the readily available website information.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's wonderful that you go out to the to do the survey. In return, the community learn about what's going on in the community, and that is the most valuable project objective.
Mm-hmm. I definitely think there's an educational component to that. I mean, my experience, I didn't find anybody who knew about the Flushing waterfront. I mean, maybe the folks who went out more often than I did can talk about it, because I found very few people. I can't remember anybody who was like, oh, I know about this. Everybody was like, oh, what's going on? So maybe guys who actually did it can share your experiences.
I remember we went to one business that was right by the corner of Northern Boulevard on Main Street.
sort of found, I did the resident survey, but I spoke about the small business survey. But I found with the residents that it seemed like the more English they spoke, the degree of fluency in English, it seemed like they were actually more aware of the downtown Flushing framework. I can only speculate as to why. I'm not really sure. Like maybe the larger New York community, like the community in New York at large, speaks about the framework more than just the, I guess, just the Asian immigrant community. I'm not really sure. But I found that the more English they spoke, the more they would be aware of the downtown Flushing framework.
And it also then means that the institutions and the agencies that are involved in community planning, they need to make their materials available in different languages and do that strategic outreach to immigrant communities to inform them about
development. It's almost
as if
they're kept in the dark. And, you know, the materials that talk about the downtown Flushing framework and about, you know, the need for sanitation and the need for parks and open space, they're usually only written in English, so they actually miss the, you know, what the majority of Flushing is all about, 97% Asian, so it's almost sort of a catch-22, and it's very unfair as on.
Yeah, I highly doubt any of the documents available on these websites are translated in. Sean,
I think in addition to just like the local, that was my experience as well. A lot of people didn't have a clue about what was going on downtown Flushing framework. And if I take it even a step further, I didn't know there was a downtown Flushing framework. I never became the Flushing until I was in this class. And, but I think to the point Stephen Choi makes that, all right, it's happening in Flushing, but it's still going to be a ripple effect, which is going to have an effect outside of Flushing. Yeah, it's going to redevelop Flushing and have the largest impact here, but it's not going to happen in a vacuum. There's going to be a ripple effect. And I think the fact that even with people I know, like family members, friends, whatever the case, and I tell them about this course, and then like the Flushing who? You know, they never heard, they don't know, and it's just, you know, the awareness. Not many people are aware of what's going on, and I think that's
and
why
it's transformative.
Yeah.
What the city envisions for Willets Point, a brand new neighborhood, is really transformative of North Point.
That's right.
Nipa. Can I just say, although like most of, I did small business surveys, and although most of the businesses that I surveyed weren't aware of the framework or development plan, they did show like an interest in kind of becoming a part of, or becoming more involved in, they showed an interest in like, you know, that they did have, they were invested in this process, and that, you know, they did have things to say, or a lot of people shared, you know, what they'd like to see in terms of development, even, like, as well as on the surveys, they spoke to us, and, you know, they were very engaged.
Next question. I guess, like, think in terms of community and Flushing community. I'm from Bayside, but, you know, my parents and family come in often. So I saw that the survey, there were small business surveys and resident surveys. How would you be able to, would you include those commuters as part of Flushing community, and how would you include that in the survey process?
That's an interesting question. Yeah, we didn't. You're right. I think that you're right. Targeted. You're right. That's an important. There are an important stakeholder group.
What is Flushing too? That's what I was thinking about.
Okay, that's right. I think that might be some follow-up surveying work that the MinKwon Center and Queens College might continue to think about and possibly do. But you're right, when the Rebuild Chinatown Initiative did their surveying work, they actually also kind of just stopped people on the street. So people who are visitors or people who are commuters coming through in terms of using the transportation hubs here, that, you're right, we didn't actually capture their views. It was residents and it was those that worked and owned small businesses. So maybe something to do in the future. You have to keep in mind, one semester class, they did a lot of great work. So
I think that's right. I think, you know, Flushing's has really evolved in a lot of different ways. It's, as Professor Hum mentioned, it's a transit hub. You have the Long Island Railroad coming through here, you have the 7 train, you have a whole lot of buses coming through here. It really is, in a lot of ways, one of the biggest, if not the biggest, hub of the immigrant community in New York York City. So there are a lot of interests that are at play here. At the same time, so I definitely think that, you know, when we move on to larger visions and thinking about how to engage the entire community and all the different stakeholders, you know, commuters' interests, I think that could definitely be part of it. That being said, I think we want to focus in the beginning, at least on who is going to be directly affected on a day-to-day basis by some of these issues. Because at the end of the day, you know, those are the people who are going to be here and who are going to be living this, you know, the reality of having a very large development, for better or for worse. So I think that's why we really focused in the beginning on the local residents and the small businesses right in that area.
And you had a question about the geographic boundaries.
Yeah.
Were you curious how we identified this, where we
yeah.
went? Maybe Jake? Sorry, do you want to address how you identified kind of the specific streets or for surveying? It sounds like you surveyed along the major commercial corridors, but then how did you identify where to send those to do resident
yeah,
surveys?
Yeah, I just look at the Google map.
Mm-hmm. What is walkable? That's
yeah,
true.
Yeah.
From
Google,
right.
Far, we can't reach that, that area, right?
That's
or
right.
I look at the Google map first, and then I
yes.
just, you know, and then I visit that, you know, that niche, you know, area. There is lots of buildings. You know, I just decided to go.
Okay, great.
Not,
So it was driven by very practical concerns that
yeah.
we had to be able to walk to where we were conducting our surveys. Right.
And also it had to be near the Flushing River, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. Those are the immediate stakeholders. Alex, did you have something to say?
Yeah.
Just about your experience or
yeah,
observation?
I was just saying about the ripple effect and Suji's slide about the amenities in Willets Point, things like the entertainment center.
Right.
I mean, I think you see this happen in a lot of different neighborhoods around the city, like Chinatown, for example. Like,
sure.
you know, there are all these fights in Chinatown and Manhattan to make sure, you know, that it doesn't become, what did they call it, like a Disneyland? Or
right, Disney-fied, sure. Like
Disney-fied thing, like, oh, look at the Chinese down in Chinatown, go, and then you, you know.
Right.
I think that it's
your
important.
Park image.
Yeah, and then I think that it's important to understand that a lot of times these are neighborhoods with people who live and work and
yeah.
and you know, go to school and all these things and are really trying to make a living here. So how do you make sure that, you know, it doesn't become, you know, one of those kinds of you know, how it really maintains its character as a neighborhood, the ties that bind folks together, as opposed to just simply a Disney-fied sort of area. I think these are really important. And a lot of times I think they get overlooked because, you know, it's great to show some really fancy-looking rendering of all these shiny, new, huge buildings and things like that, but, you know, what's the reality? We don't want this to become sort of a hollowed-out city where, you know, you just have very upper-class residents who are living here who don't necessarily have a connection with that community. And where do all those folks go? Right? Farther away into other places, and I think a lot of it's really easy to lose that character.
This is, again, I think that the intention of this was to start the conversation.
Yes.
Right? And MinKwon Center will continue to organize other meetings and follow-ups on the plan for the downtown Flushing waterfront. So this is just the beginning, and I, again, want to thank the students. And, oh, Regina, did you have something?
I was just wondering, from a student's perspective, this is my first time surveying, going door-to-door. Mm-hmm. And I really enjoyed it. And a lot of hard work went into it, and I really admire the work of MinKwon because, you can get the door shut in your face so many times, but you just keep going, and I really enjoyed the class of this semester. Yeah.
Great. Well, thank you. Thank you, everyone, for coming.